one of your big shows that's touring at the moment is ABBAmania, which I know people just love. The music of ABBA lives on in Mamma Mia in the West End, and your show, which has had international success as well. We're never going to get sick of those tunes done well, are we?
No, I don't think so. I mean, it's I don't know. In the 70s, people laughed at it and laughed at their costumes and laughed at the simple pop tunes, as they called them then. But of course, they were anything but. They were intricate. They were well written. They were classics, and they will remain classics for many years to come. I mean, we've got two casts of ABBAmania working at the moment. One cast works in the UK and in Europe. They're in France right now. They were in Paris on Saturday. My son was there, and they're touring France for the next 3 or 4 weeks. But we've also got a cast that performs in America. And I think they were in Florida at the weekend, or they're in Florida coming up this weekend. So yeah, it's a great show in the sense that it plays all the tunes. It again does what it says on the tin, ABBAmania. If you like ABBA, I mean, they go play the Palace in Manchester, places like that all over the country, and they sell huge amounts of tickets. And again, they deliver huge amounts of pleasure. You know, when you see those people on a Friday night, all dressed up in their ABBA wigs and their ABBA clothes, and they're enjoying. You know, as soon as you turn on, I mean, I'm sure you know it anyway as a radio presenter. As soon as you switch on or start to perform Dancing Queen, the floor fills up, yeah. and people's even in your own home, your smile broadens. You people love it, that song, and not many of the other songs that they did, of course, but I think ABBA music will live forever, frankly.
Yeah, you can't lose. I mean, you talk about people laughing at it in the 70s. I think even ABBA laughed at it in the 70s. The boys, Benny and Bjorn, I mean, even they saw how ridiculous it was, but their music lives on. And you've put on a big production. I mean, this isn't just some sort of sing-along karaoke show. It's a big light show, a great sound system, because without it, it would look a bit rubbish, wouldn't it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's the difficulty with presenting any kind of a tribute or celebration show. You can have the bad ones with the bad wigs and the bad costumes and the bad lighting that performs in a pub, still performing lovely music, or you can present it in a much bigger and better way in a theatre, and people do they enjoy I suppose both versions of it. But when you present it in such a way that you can charge, you know, perhaps £20 or something for a ticket, you've got to put some production values into it, and you've got to make it look like it's at the London Palladium or somewhere. I mean, back in the 70s, I promoted two ABBA shows when I was working with Danny Bittesh at Kennedy Street, and ABBA came to this country and they performed four shows. One of them was at Manchester's Free Trade Hall, and it was a fantastic experience. They just brought out the Arrival album, and they had this sort of sound of this helicopter as though it was landing on the stage, and they were just fantastic. And of course, I don't know if you're aware of this, but do you know what a Super Trooper is?
No.
Okay. Well, Super Trooper is a huge spotlight that you see in an arena.
Oh, right.
or in a big theatre. Mm. And they wrote the song Super Trooper on one of our shows in Glasgow. And if you listen to the words, I was sick and tired of everything,
yeah.
when I called you last night from Glasgow.
Yeah.
All I do is eat and
drink
sleep
and sing, yeah.
wishing every show was the last show. And it then goes on, you know, you're like a super trooper light that's going to find me. And what had happened was he was getting divorced from Agnetha,
yeah.
and he'd obviously met someone else who was back home in Sweden, and he was sick and tired of performing and going around hotels and travelling and so on, and wanted to get back home. But his guiding light at that point was a you're like a super trooper, like that's going to find me, you know, smiling like the sun, and so on, shining like the sun. So it's interesting. It's a wonderful pop song about a spotlight.
Wow! So it's like a Pin Focus. How amazing! I didn't know that. Fantastic.
There you are. You see, I'm full of old rock and roll nonsense.
Well, and you are, and that's what's great about you. You've worked with everybody, and you get the business. It has changed a lot. How difficult is it selling tickets now? Because, I mean, the people you work with, what's interesting, I saw Roy Chubby Brown last Friday in Leicester. He sold 800 tickets. A good pal of mine is Russell Watson, who always sells out. I mean, you don't work with duds, do you? Is that deliberate, or is it just that you've fell lucky with the talent that you like and appreciate?
I discovered him about 20 years ago in a work. Well, it was a social club at the Style Women's Prison. They had a social club there for the officers and for the staff. And I was encouraged to go and see him. And it was a dreadfully wet, cold February night, horrible misty night. And I drove in there. And when I saw him, I was booking at the time. I was booking the North Pier and putting shows into the North Pier at Blackpool for a 16-18 week summer season, and I had one that summer with Lily Savage. So I booked Russell when I saw him that night. I immediately booked him as kind of bottom of the bill, and I remember Kim Gavin directed that show, who went on then to do Take That and all those great shows that Take That do, and he actually did the last night of the Olympics in 2012. A fantastic choreographer, director, this guy, and he did the show for us, and we had Russell on there at bottom of the bill, and he did 20 minutes, but he stopped the show. You know, the audience absolutely loved it, and then he went and did, I think he went and did a Bradford band tour for us, and then he did Blackpool the following year at the Opera House with Jane McDonald, who'd just come off a TV program called The Cruise. And Russell was bottom of the bill again. And anyway, what happened then, he went on to do a football ground, Manchester United's football ground, and it was in 99 when they were playing in the final of the European Trophy, the Champions League thing, and he sang in the football ground in Barcelona, and he was sensational, and this record executive picked him up at that point, and obviously the rest is history. He went and made the albums and became very successful, and at this point in time, he'd left us, and he'd gone with these people in London and so on, and for whatever reason it didn't work out, and then he got sick, and he had a succession of sort of managers and agents and so on. And then last September, he called me up and said, you know, do you want to come and have a cup of tea with me, and can we talk? And he said, when I work, I do arenas, and you can only do about 15 of them, or if I do the big sort of concert halls like the one in Nottingham or the one in Manchester, I can only do about 20. He said, and I'm sat in the house 9 months a year. I want to go out and work. I want to go and sing. I want to go and perform. And so I persuaded him to look at it in a different way and work without the huge concert orchestra, to work with probably, say, four strings, a string quartet, maybe a piano and guitar, and let's go and do all of the theatres that you missed out during your career, like Inverness or Norwich or Aberystwyth or Canterbury. And we gave him 50 dates that then, because people wanted to double up, he'd sold out and so on and so forth, has now become 60. And now, because of the demand, I'm adding another 25 in the autumn. So he's going to play about, probably just shy of 100 shows live this year, which of course he's loving, because he's getting out there and playing to his fans and to the people that want to see him.
And you make it sound very easy, but it's not. There's a lot of acts out there who aren't making money and are certainly not selling out. So this is extraordinary. We should say that. This isn't common in show business, is it?
Well, no, it isn't. Of course it isn't. I mean, but as you said earlier at the end, the end of the day, the public themselves decide who they want to go and see. I mean, we as promoters and producers can only put them in front of the public, and you guys play your part because you do your interviews. And I saw one yesterday with Russell, which I think you did.
Yeah,
that was in the Sunday Mirror.
Yeah, they wanted it. Yeah, it was a great interview he did with that, actually.
Yeah, and so you guys play your part in helping us to promote these guys to put them in front of the British public. And I mean, the British public are under such a lot of pressure for their disposable entertainment pound or their disposable entertainment income. When you look at the amount of shows that are on in any major city in the theatres there or in the arenas or the concert halls, I mean, you know, if you wanted to go and, or you could afford to go and see everyone you wanted to go and see, it costs you thousands and thousands of pounds, really.
Yeah.
I just looked at the programme for the Manchester Arena for the rest of this year, and I want to go to all the shows, and although I'm reasonably successful, I don't think even I could afford the tickets for that lot. It's phenomenal, the lineup these places have got.
Yeah, it's extraordinary. And you've got shows happening all over the country, as you say. Russell Watson's on tour this year, Roy Chubby Brown's on tour, and Abermania is coming to a theatre near you.
Yes, indeed. They're touring from April, the middle of April, and they're going all around the country, places like Wimbledon and Whitley Bay, and, you know, Edinburgh to Ipswich, and Reading to Darlington. So yeah, all over the UK, you'll be able to catch up on an ABBA show, and everybody loves a bit of ABBA, don't they?
They do. It's brilliant, timeless, and fantastic. And you do it so well. That's the point. This isn't some half-bit show that's just trying to rake in the money. You give the audience what they deserve, which is a real feel-good show with big production, because without it, I think they'd suss it out. That's why it's touring the world. Abermania.com is the website you can go to. Stuart Littlewood is the producer and the man behind Handshake, and really an incredible life and an incredible career. Keep on keeping on, won't you?